92.1 WROI. It is now 8:08 on a quite pleasant Monday morning, actually, and it's time for Doc Talk, our monthly conversation with Dr. Eric Seward, OBGYN at Woodlawn Hospital. Yes, correct?
Yes, exactly right.
No big changes there?
Nope.
All righty, then. You're the guy on all the TV shows that solves every problem in an hour.
Oh, everyone in an hour.
Doctors, doctors and cops. Unless it's continued next week, which usually means you got some weird thing going on that doesn't have anything to do with medicine, but still. Anyway, what are we talking about today?
Well, we're actually going to talk about the menstrual cycle, specifically as it relates to getting pregnant and early pregnancy. This is a topic that in my world happens. It's a conversation I have every single day I'm in the office, and it relates to just about everything that I do in one form or another, in the sense that I take care of pregnancies. We're trying to help people get pregnant that are having problems with infertility.
Is that a fairly sizable portion of your...
It happens. I've got a handful of people at any given time that are working at it, that we're working with. And as a generalist, this is something that we kind of have the first couple of steps in. And when you get to the really complicated stuff, then it goes off to a specialist for, you know, things like in vitro, which is beyond what I'm going to do in a small community. But that said, and even when we're trying to keep people from getting pregnant, this all kind of relates. It's one of those topics that, I think there may be men out there that are listening right now going, oh, Lord, why do we have to talk about this? but I think
it's because our life is so simple.
if you dig in, it really is kind of an interesting topic. And I'm going to try to make it interesting anyway. And I want to try to make it simple. First and foremost, we have a very interesting system. We're unique in that we have as many opportunities to get pregnant in any given year as we do. Most animals don't work on a month-to-month basis. Anybody that takes care of animals knows that. There's a breeding season, usually once or twice a year, maybe more often, but it's not nearly as sort of prevalent and as relentless as it is for people.
Many of our hunting laws revolve around that particular season.
That's probably true. Yeah, that's probably true. With regards to menstrual cycles, you got to keep in mind that the whole point is to create pregnancy. That's the point of a cycle. And we have evolved our thinking in modern world as to the health or the reliability or what we expect out of that. One of the more interesting chapters, I think, there's a big book called Williams Obstetrics. It's like one of the Bibles, if you will, of obstetrics. One of the very first chapters talks about how menstrual cycles are abnormal. Having a menstrual cycle is not normal. And they go on to justify that argument by saying that if you look at indigenous people in places like the bush of Africa, or if you were to go to some remote island somewhere, Borneo or something like that, you would find that people there start menstrual cycles later. It has to do with lean body mass. It has to do with lifestyle and subsistence living. They get married very early. They have children. They breastfeed their children until they're much older. And so having a menstrual cycle during any of those times is sort of an oddity. It doesn't happen very often. People that are in those kinds of cultures may have 5 or 6 periods over the course of an entire lifetime.
Really?
Yes, because they get pregnant when they can. Basically, they don't have cycles because they are breastfeeding, and then when it happens again, they get pregnant again. And it goes on, and there's usually a relatively short lifespan. Now, we in modern times control these things. We control birth, we control cycles. So it's almost turned to a point of health. There are a lot of folks out there that think that you have to have a monthly cycle to clean things out, or that's sort of the purpose of it. But I would like to kind of turn both arguments on end. I think that cycles happen. They happen for a very specific reason, and that is to create pregnancy. And most of the things that we do to either augment that or prevent that are sort of working with that system. And it starts something like this. there are signals from the hypothalamus. The hypothalamus is that part of the brain, that central part of the brain that controls all the things that we don't want to have to think about, like breathing and body temperature and stuff like that. So the autonomic part of our brain is in control of all of these sort of basic functions. And it's also control of all of our endocrine system. So it sends signals out to a little gland called the pituitary gland, which then is sort of magnifies those signals and sends those signals off to various glands about our bodies. So think about this in terms of a testicle or an ovary. There are two signal hormones. This is a complicated system, so it requires two whole hormones that are sent out in both waves and pulses. So it has to do with the amount of the prohormone or the signal hormone and the sort of the dot, 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 dash, dot, dash, dot.
I can identify with that in radio.
Yeah, it's very similar to, maybe a Morse code-y kind of thing where there are waves and amplitude, there are amounts, and there are sort of how it's pulsatile.
How much space is in between each wave?
And there are two hormones. They're called follicle-stimulating hormone and luteinizing hormone. Interestingly, men and women use the same two hormones. They go down, they hit their signal receptors, and they create a response. With guys, it's pretty much constant. There's one job. We make sperm. That's what we do. With the ovaries, it's a little more complicated because you have to develop an egg. But you also have to develop the sort of the bedding, if you will, for the pregnancy. So every month, this process starts. The first half of the cycle is built around estrogen. Estrogen is made by the ovary. It builds up the lining of the uterus, hoping that someday a little baby will come along and implant itself. In mid-cycle, there is what we call an LH surge. So a little extra boost of hormone gets sent from the pituitary gland that tells the egg to release. Basically, there's a little cyst that forms on the ovary called a follicle, and that follicle has an egg in it, and it pops, and it releases that egg to float down the tube looking for a sperm. If it finds one, a pregnancy happens, lands in the that fluffy lining of the uterus that's been formed by that estrogen. Then the second half of the cycle is now what we call the luteal half of the cycle. That remaining follicle cyst kind of converts itself into what we call a corpus luteum, and it primarily produces progesterone. Progesterone is one of these fun naming things. I always wanted to sit on one of those committees that names medicines. They have some of the most ridiculous names, but progesterone, I kind of like the name of this one because it is a progestational hormone, progesterone. It's named very much for what it does. And it basically is there to support that early pregnancy until it gets established. So assuming there's a pregnancy, and we're hoping that if all goes well and pregnancy is the end goal in this particular cycle, that a sperm found an egg somewhere out in the end of the fallopian tube. They did their dance. They decided it was a go. They floated down the tube. As they did so, that cell, that egg cell that's now fertilized, divides into what we call first a morula, then a blastula, then a blastocyst. And as that's happening, it's sort of involuting and starting to specialize a little bit. As it lands on the lining of the uterus, the first cells are called trophoblasts that make contact. They go in, they find the blood supply, and they set up camp. And from that point forward, if it's a normal pregnancy and everything's a go, things start to grow and specialize into placenta, baby, and then from simple baby to baby parts, you know, things that, right, that actually make a whole person. And that happens relatively fast. It happens over the course of a few weeks. By the time you get out to about 7 or 8 weeks, we can identify that baby. You can identify a head end and a tail end. You can identify most of the organs have already been formed or they're in the process of forming. And by 10 or 12 weeks, you have something that looks exactly like a baby on a much smaller scale,
right,
and has all of the functioning parts, although they may be immature and they may not be ready. So if there's no if there were no sperm to meet with the egg, or if the egg and sperm for whatever reason didn't do their thing, that egg floats down. There's a set amount of time our brains are kind of monitoring, and if it doesn't happen, the hypothalamus will say time to start over, and everything goes back. There's a period that sheds off, and the whole thing resets and starts again. So that's why periods happen. Periods are a failure to get pregnant. Now, in most of the, a big chunk of my job is preventing pregnancy. We get a lot of this. And most of the methods that we use to prevent pregnancy are things that mimic cycles. So again, we're in this culture now where most people think of a menstrual cycle as a necessary monthly cleaning. Not exactly true. You know, you could go back to that first argument. But we've grown accustomed to this. And so things like birth control pills, NuvaRings, Orthonovum patches are all ways to sort of mimic cycles but prevent that ovulation in the mid part of that cycle. Things that mess with that, or sometimes equally, almost equally, I get people coming in with problems with their periods, saying, you know, they either have pain or excessive bleeding or too many periods or too few periods or cysts on ovaries, things of these nature. These are all sort of byproducts, if you will, of this process. And so sometimes we're trying to get rid of periods altogether. And some of our birth control options, things like the Mirena IUDs or the Depo Provera shots or the Nexplanon implants, some of those things might get rid of periods. Or they may monkey with periods in such a way that that it changes that monthly rhythm. And these are all sort of individualized things, but they're byproducts of trying to make it so that somebody doesn't get pregnant or to deal with some of the side effects of these issues. On the other hand, some people are really trying to get pregnant. And my focus today was really to kind of go through how that normally happens and sort of how people should think about it. So if I've got a couple out there, and I do, that are trying to get pregnant, and they're thinking about this process, one of the things that I always point out to people is that the average cycle is about 28 days. That's variable. We're people. You know, there's margins of error. So not anybody behaves exactly like the next person. But 28 is about the average. And so if you could imagine a 28-day cycle is divided roughly equally into that follicular and that luteal phase, that means that right around day 14 is going to be the dividing line. Now, it's interesting because it turns out that the luteal phase, the second half, is almost always 14 days. So if a person doesn't have a perfect 28-day cycle, they have a 31-day cycle or a 26-day cycle, it turns out that you have to kind of take that number minus 14, and that kind of gives you a little bit better idea of where that ovulation is likely going to happen. That's one of the very first things. That's going to be the most fertile point in that cycle. So if somebody out there is actually trying to get pregnant and they're trying to think through, well, when should I set up my next big date night? Probably sometime right around that, whenever that ovulation point is. And we usually say that in the doctor's office, I would say, well, you look at it plus or minus about 48 hours, because it's impossible to really pinpoint that. Mm-hmm. There are over-the-counter ovulation predictor kits, but I don't necessarily encourage people to do that to try to figure out any given cycle when they're ovulating. I would say those are helpful in first of all determining, are you in fact ovulating, because that's one of the problems I deal with sometimes, and if so, about when. And instead of wasting a lot of money and putting a lot of pressure on any given cycle, you should just sort of generally say, okay, it's probably about here. And then you can kind of roughly assess where in that cycle things likely are going to happen. Now, that said, when you kind of have that part pinpointed, then the next step is, and this is a next problem that I run into a lot in the office, is we get a lot of people that have positive pregnancy tests that are super, super early. So people come in and they'll say, I had a positive. And they always come in and say, I have 5 positive pregnancy tests. One is plenty. You know, once it's positive, it's positive. There are things that are called sensitivity and specificity, which are terms in statistics. Specificity means how many times is a negative test truly negative. Sensitivity means how many times is a positive test truly positive. So how many false positives would be sort of the function of sensitivity.
Mm-hmm. It's like the difference between accurate and precise.
Something like that, yeah. And with regards to pregnancy tests, they are very sensitive. So if they're positive, they're almost always positive. It doesn't mean you're going to have a baby in 9 months necessarily, because there's a lot of other issues, but positive tests are positive. If you have one, you don't necessarily need to repeat it. Occasionally, somebody may look and say, gee, I don't know, is this really a positive? And some of the tests are a little confusing for some people. But in all honesty, if you see it, it's obviously a positive, whichever test you pick, you make a call. You call my office, we get you in, and we figure it out from there. If you have a negative test, then that's not necessarily as specific, because timing matters. A lot of times what's happening in the modern world is somebody has they're a day late on their period, which can be caused by a whole lot of different things. They take a test, it comes back mildly positive. And now we're kind of in this quasi range where there's not a lot of information I can give somebody. It's super early. And in times past, you know, we'll just go back to probably when we were kids. At that point in time, the tests weren't nearly as accurate or as quick. And so ultimately, you know, if somebody had a period a week later, that may have represented an early miscarriage, but nobody was any wiser. You know, we just all walked around thinking, oh, my period was late this week or this month. And now everybody's finding out, you know, because of these super sensitive tests. And it creates a lot of anxiety for patients. So I always tell people, if you suspect you might be pregnant, your period doesn't come right on time, wait a week. Don't judge it yet. Wait a week. If it's still not there, take the pregnancy test. If it's negative, wait another week. Take a pregnancy test. If it's positive, or, you know, then give us a call if it's negative. You know, there's a set amount of time. You know, sometimes stress and other things might impact that. But then you call us and we get you in and we go through the process. There are two kinds of pregnancy tests. One is what we call a qualitative test. It's a yes-no test, a positive-negative. It's the pee on the stick from the drugstore test. Same one that we use in the office to just say yes or no. Then there are what we call quantitative tests that actually give a number associated with it. And this is where things get interesting for me. It turns out that 5 is sort of the yes-no line. So if it's below 5, it's considered negative. If it's above 5, it's considered positive. And I think it's somewhere around 15 or 20 that it actually relates to the tests over the counter. That's when they start to become positive. But these things double about every 48 hours or so, up until they reach about a peak at about 10 weeks pregnancy of about 100 to 150,000. So, you know, I always use that in terms of dollars and cents. That's the difference between a Big Mac and a house.
Right.
You know, it's a huge jump. And it goes up, predictably about every 36 to 48 hours, it doubles until it reaches that peak. And then it starts to fall back down until it hits a plateau somewhere around the 15 or 16 week mark. This is a very good tool for me for a lot of reasons, and it explains a few things to people. For me, it's a good chance to see, is this a normal pregnancy? You know, if I'm looking and I'm trying to put my dates and what I'm seeing on an ultrasound together with these numbers, it kind of gives me an idea of, are we on the right track? Or are we not on the right track? If you see those numbers stall out, or if you see those numbers start to fall when they shouldn't be falling, that's a pretty good sign that there's probably a miscarriage, or sometimes maybe an ectopic pregnancy, a pregnancy in a tube or somewhere else. It also corresponds with things like morning sickness. When that HCG, which is the pregnancy hormone, gets to its peak, that's when people tend to have the most morning sickness. So HCG is very directly related to nausea and vomiting in pregnancy. And it tends to kind of come back down and fade away. So one of my reassuring bits of advice is that, you know, it gets bad, you know, somewhere around 8 to 12 weeks, but it usually kind of comes back and is fairly stable after 14 or 15 weeks. And that's something to look forward to if you're miserable. So that said, you know, these all are tools that I use, because you could imagine when people show up at 5 weeks pregnant, barely pregnant, with their 5 positive pregnancy tests at home, and you know, and we're looking, we can't see a whole lot with an ultrasound until about 6 weeks, and even then it's, you know, you're just on the verge of maybe being able to confirm a heartbeat. That's when we can use some of these other tools to sort of figure out, are we heading in the right direction, and what advice do I give somebody. There's about a zillion things that can go wrong.
Right.
I always use the example, because it's easy to understand, of 2 sperm getting into 1 egg. There are mechanisms to prevent that. Nature kind of has its sort of shutdown valve, but it doesn't always work. And if you get 2 sperm into 1 egg, now all of a sudden you've got 3 sets of genetic material that doesn't make a normal pregnancy, but it sometimes makes a pregnancy. Right. So a lot of times we'll get this triploidy of genetics floating down the tube, landing, setting up camp, creating a pregnancy, but it's never going to be a baby. It's going to be at most likely a miscarriage.
So twins are 2 eggs that get fertilized?
Most of the time twins are 2 eggs that get fertilized, or they're an egg that gets fertilized by 1 sperm that splits.
Okay.
There's a point at which sometimes those, and that's when you get identical twins.
That's the maternal?
Fraternal twins, or what we like to call dizygotic twins, come from 2 separate eggs.
I'm glad you
monozygotic twins are identical twins, and they come from 1 egg that split at some point.
Now, you were talking about people that have a difficulty getting pregnant. It's interesting that you brought that up, and this is a subject, because I was privy to a conversation this weekend that people were legitimately worried about something, and they just didn't know. You have a young lady, young man who were getting together in the beginnings of a relationship, and the parents were sitting around talking, and both of these were difficult pregnancies. Mm-hmm. Last gasp effort to get it done, finally did.
Yeah.
That being the case, if they get together, if they get married, will they have then a higher rate or higher chance of having difficulty becoming pregnant, carrying it to term?
The short answer is probably not.
Okay.
But there's a lot of sub factors that go into that. Almost everything in our lives is impacted by our genetic matrix.
Right.
Okay. But it's almost, most things in our life are what we call multifactorial things. So my dad had a heart attack. Does that mean I'm going to have a heart attack? Well, My odds increase because of that, but that doesn't mean I'm going to have a heart attack. You know, I might get hit by a bus.
Right.
And, you know, there's a lot of different things that sort of impact that, from how we live our lives to the other set of genetics.
Yeah.
And some things that create problems with getting pregnant have to do with timing. Some of them have to do with, you know, stress plays a big factor. We see this a lot when people go through a big process of infertility, and maybe they do in vitro fertilization, and after the 5th time, and after they've drained their bank account, they finally get pregnant. It's just, you know, a miracle, and they're so excited about it, and they have the baby, and, you know, 8 months later they find out that they're pregnant again, this time with no effort whatsoever.
Right.
And a little bit of that has to do with, I think, plumbing, and a little bit of that has to do with just the stress is gone. You're no longer thinking about it. A lot of times when we get this last gasp, you know, we're going to try one more time, you know, it almost boils down to throwing it into the wind. You know, when you first start, there's a lot of pressure. I will say this, things tend to happen when you least expect them to. And I would always, you know, be cautious, and I would never like put anything off specifically because, you know, of a parent history.
Right.
But, you know, there's we have some rules, too, that I follow. And generally speaking, if that same young couple is now trying and they've tried for a year and they haven't been successful with, like, nothing inhibiting them, it doesn't mean there's anything wrong specifically, but it's usually at that point that we would say, okay, well, let's look into this. Okay. And sometimes there are simple solutions. Sometimes it's more complicated. It's a good sign if, backing up to the original topic of periods, it's a good time. It's a good sign if cycles are regular. Cycles in ovulation are the number one female factor in fertility issue that I deal with. So if you're having regular periods, there's a really good chance that you're having regular ovulations. And that's a really good sign. It's one of the bigger slices of the pie. You get a sperm count. If that comes back normal, then, you know, you've covered, you know, a good 75-80% of the common causes. And if both of those things are a go, then it's a matter of looking into a few other things. But most of the time, it's going to work out.
Again, speaking with Dr. Eric Seward for Doc Talk, which we do on a monthly basis. Doc, as we wrap this up, is there any other stuff you want to touch on real quick? Or?
Oh, you know, I'm always happy to, when people have questions. Like I said, in my day-to-day world, it's impossible. I didn't look at my schedule for today. I'll go in from here and look at it. But I'll bet you it wouldn't be surprising if there are a couple of people on the list that are new OB patients. If we don't have a couple of people on the list that are wanting birth control, if I don't have somebody on the list that has a cyst on an ovary or is having irregular cycles or polycystic ovarian syndrome, and probably one person that's either been trying or wants to start trying getting pregnant. And every single one of those patients I just mentioned, along with all the ones that have gotten pregnant, this is a very specific topic, and it's the way my brain kind of processes these problems,
right,
as I think through, well, what do we need to do, or what is the situation here? So I think it's good. A lot of people have there's a lot of myth out there about periods, mm-hmm. and, you know, it's one of those things that nobody ever wants to talk about, so I don't know how many people turned off the radio when they heard the topic, but or how many people turned it up and wanted to listen a little bit more. But that's it is one of those sort of semi-taboo, filled with lots of myth. And I think when you break it down to its real basic science, everything starts to make sense,
right.
and it does come online.
Excellent. Again, speaking with Dr. Eric Seward, sir, thank you very kindly for your time, as always.
All right. Look forward to next month.
836-92.1 WROI.